wonderful. You've been doing a great job evangelizing bytecode and Comdi and Java 13 and bleeding edge things, and I believe everyone uses bytebuddy these days.
Maybe not everybody, but a fair amount of people. Thanks, Marcus. Yes, that's why it's called a field report. I'm not working on a virtual machine anywhere. I'm a consultant working with end customers. I'm based in Oslo, but I have quite a few users out over the world. And I want to talk about my experiences. I'm also very involved in open source, so I think I know the library space fairly well. And I've been working a lot with getting things to work on Java 9 Plus over the last 2 years. And I'm happy to report that most things I'm involved with work quite well, even on Java 13 these days. I am quite happy that we spoke a lot about startup time. I'm also going to speak a lot about startup time. Unfortunately, I'm going the opposite direction. I'm talking about why things got much slower on Java 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, and why this is. And I'm also making a few suggestions how we could avoid this. So I'm talking from experience here. If you have any questions, because of course a lot of people here have a different background to me, just ask me, right? We use a lot of unsafe in open source, and by we, I mean basically anybody who's running Java software in the enterprise. I'm doing a library called ByteBuddy. Maybe not everybody knows it. It's a bytecode generation manipulation library, mostly used for Java agents, but also for proxying. And it's underneath a lot of libraries out there. Before that, I was involved in zglib, which I retired from because the code base was written in Java 1.1, and it looks like it was written in Java 1.1. We didn't get anywhere with it anymore. We couldn't make any change without breaking a lot of people. So I said, like, yep, we have to make something new. And Java 9 helped a lot in spreading this message because zglib just doesn't work anymore, or not that well anymore, at least. I'm also on the core team of Hibernate, mostly helping out with bytecode generation there. And I'm also the core developer of Mockito, one of the core developers. Also mainly doing bytecode generation and manipulation stuff. And I'm also consulting for a lot of Java agent vendors, mainly for Instana, which is like a performance monitoring tool. And I'm also having customers in the security space for security agents. And just a quick recap, what is bytecode manipulation and generation used for? Basically, we have two modes of generation. The one is actually creating new classes, mainly used for subclass proxying, like in Spring, like in Hibernate, where you subclass a user class at runtime and you basically intercept method calls by overriding the methods because they're dispatched virtually, so you can basically install hooks into user code. And then you have retransformation, where you install a Java agent for the most, where you retransform classes before they get loaded. And I split the use cases into two big scenarios. Some just want to observe things and not change any behavior. And some people actually want to change behavior. So obviously, in Mockito, we do mocking. So we basically override methods to do nothing, such that the mock works. Or in a security agent, we intercept, for example, JDBC calls, and we scan them for SQL injections and these things to basically fail the call if we detect something that is suspicious. And I guess most of you guys know how to do these things. How do we instrument classes? That's the Java Agent API. I'm not going to go into the details of how that works. It's not so important, actually, for the talk either. But just for those who don't know, since Java 5, you can install a class file transformer in a Java agent that basically gets notified every time a class is loaded. And that's then just a function from one bytecode array to another bytecode array that represents a class in the state it's found in a jar file and in the state it is actually loaded before it is loaded by a class loader. And actually, I think Wiley introduced this API for the purpose of APM, of performance monitoring. And that's actually where it's used the most, I think, nowadays. And just to mention the scope, I think no production environment, or of course some, but many, many production environments out there are monitored by all these agents, by Instana, AppDynamics, New Relic. So this is not a niche product. Even though the API might seem to be used by very few people, it reaches, I'd say, a very fair amount of production JVMs. And this is why it's important that these things work, and that's why we fight so hard to get things working on all VMs since Java 5, which ByteBuddy still supports, up to Java 13, which ByteBuddy also supports. Apart from transformation, we all know SunMisc unsafe define class. This was the go-to API everybody used and a lot of people still use. for defining classes. And there was no alternative up to Java 9, and this is why this got so spread. And then in Java 9, we were educated, this is unsafe API, which we all knew all of the time, but we didn't have an alternative, right? But method handlers then introduced, offered a better way, or a more secure way, and a more organized way of defining classes. It still applied the security model of the JVM, because if you don't have access to a module, if it doesn't open to your module, then you can protect your module from injecting code into that module. And the thing is, of course, people don't find that convenient, but if you think of the scope, like if someone hacks my machine, then they can upload an artifact to Mayhem Central. Millions of developers will download ByteBuddy. ByteBuddy has access to everything using Sun Miscon Safe. And for example, it's part of Hibernate. I can just add some hooks to extract credit card numbers. So this is a good change. It's a necessary change. Of course, we'd like to ignore it, and we'd like to not have to deal with all this struggle. But in my opinion, it's a good way forward. But it's still not sufficient, unfortunately, in my opinion. And I'll explain why in a minute. And of course, also since Java 9, we have JDK internal MISC unsafe, which is the exact equivalent to Sun MISC unsafe. But it's an internal module that you normally do not have access to. And this is basically just the drop-in replacement for all JVM internal classes that have used unsafe before, because of course the JDK internal classes are vouched for by Oracle. They are checked to not do any harm. For a library, you cannot get this guarantee. You cannot run a certification process where Oracle says, Raphael, you know what you're doing. You can get access to Sun MISC unsafe. So I can't use that. But of course, from an agent, you can still use JDK internal MISC unsafe. If you, for example, instrument core classes, then you have the same access as these core classes. And now, since Java 11, Sun MISC unsafe defined class is deleted. It's not there anymore. You cannot use it anymore. And everything broke. But we're back on track. I'll explain how in a minute. So, a short agenda of what I want to go through. I'll start with defining classes from Java Agent, which might not seem like an obvious requirement. I'll show in a minute why it is actually very common. I'll not talk about transforming classes from Java Agents, because that's what Java Agents do, and there's no trick there. There's nothing you need to know. There's official stable API that you can and should use to do that. And then I'll talk about defining classes from libraries and about transforming classes from libraries. And then we'll probably not talk about anything else, because then I'll be running out of time. But if we have time, I'll have some bonus stuff that I'm struggling with sometimes. All right, so defining classes from Java agents. Let's say you have a user class, and you have a method, and you have a Java agent where you want to change the behavior from this sample class and method. Typically, you can just install a Java agent, and you will get notified that the sample class will be loaded, and then you can change the bytecode however you want it. However, sometimes you have an API to call. You want to, for example, call a logging framework or something, and it needs an object or a class of something. And the API that you want to interact with accepts a callback, which is an abstract class. So you want to do this, right? You want to API invoke, and then Java in the programming language, you would just write this, and you would have an anonymous class, which is a separate class, of course, than the outer sample class. And now you have a problem, because you want to load this class. Since Java 9, we have method handles to do so, right? But what are method handles? Method handles are a representation of the rights of a class, of a loaded class, and that we don't have, because we're currently loading the class, so we're in the Java agent. So you cannot use method handles. You're not supposed to use Sun MISC unsafe anymore. Since Java 11, you cannot use Sun MISC unsafe anymore. So what do people do now? Everybody uses JDK internal MISC unsafe. And that's unfortunately the state of Java 11. So I brought this up on the mailing list. And the current proposal says that we add yet another method to the class file transformer API. We already have basically a method that just has these arguments. Then we added module in Java 9. Now we also add class definer in maybe Java 13. I don't think 12 will make any cut anymore. And that's a proposal. The proposal is not yet merged into the JDK, fortunately, because I don't think this API is doing what it's supposed to do. The current proposal says that you will get a class definer, which allows you to inject code into the exact package of the class that you're currently transforming. That means that if you inject the sample class, then the sample class lives in a package foobar, then you can inject a class into foobar and foobar only. And it sounds like sufficient, right, for most use cases. But from working with Java agents, unfortunately, this is not always easy. Right? So think of a framework that doesn't by accident resemble Okka. Right? You have a message sender receiver pattern, and you have a sender and receiver that live in two different packages. And you want to change the code such that you can tag an event. And this is basic APM work, right? You want to tag in some form of object to add some information about a distributed trace, right? You have a HTTP call coming in this one thread, then the messages sent from this thread to another thread and dispatched here and there. You want to know that all this hangs together. There's different methods of achieving that, but one of the simplest approaches is to just basically generate your own extended version of an object and send this extended object through. If you have a single point of entry and a single point of exit, that works quite well. Now you have a challenge that if you send this and you receive that, you need to have tagged event existing in the during the load time of both classes, right? The problem of a Java agent is that the Java agent is not in control of the order that classes are loaded in. So you can end up with these two scenarios. You will load sender in the sender class package, and then you have to define the tagged event in the sender package. And then afterwards, the receiver is loaded, and it will need to use the tagged event from the sender package. If receiver is loaded first, then you will have to define the class in the receiver package. And now the sender needs to basically know that this tagged event was already loaded in a different package and adopt its own bytecode to this means. This is, of course, possible. But if you have looked into a production APM agent, there's often thousands of plugins for all kinds of frameworks. And to retrofit what people wrote around the capabilities of SunMisc and Safe into this new suggested API, this would be quite an effort. And I bet to quite some certainty that most people will just choose JDK and TurtleMisc Unsafe again and keep using that API because it's modularized, but using a Java agent, you can basically open up anything. You can open module boundaries, you can retransform modules, you can inject classes into JDK internal MISC Unsafe that basically allow you to call out and so forth. You have all the possibilities. It's quite easy, actually. And if you have an easy solution, and you have an expensive solution in enterprise programming, you also always go for the easy solution, and then you complain in the next JVM release that everything breaks again. But unfortunately, that's how things are in my field of work, and I guess in everybody's field of work, right? Right. Sometimes even this workaround doesn't work because you might have to override a package private method, and to do so, the tagged event had to be in this particular package that is neither in the sender or in the receiver class, right? Then this approach doesn't work at all, right? So since I try to be a good citizen, and I really try to be a good citizen, people always suspect me of not caring and do this renegade programming where I just use all internal APIs because I'm lazy. I'm really trying to, but it's a matter of performance as also. The thing is, using this package-restricted transformation API allows you already to do class injection into any package of the JVM with using only official API. And the way to do this is you have just a package witness, like the event class, then you register a class file transformer, and from this class file transformer, you inject the class you want to inject in a package from the transformer. And then you just say instrumentation at this class file transformer registered for retransformation. And then you retransform this witness, but you will never transform it. You just basically trigger the instrumentation API to be invoked on this witness package class. And then instead of transforming a class, you just inject the helper class and you're done. So I tried this. You can emulate this already. Of course, you take an existing APM tool. You write this API, right? And you run it. And what's the result? All right. First, another strategy. This is actually a popular one as well. The lookup class, the method lang invoke lookup class, defines a public lookup object that only allows you to look up public API. But for internal usage, it also defines an impl lookup class instance, which allows you to inject code into any package of the entire VM, including Java Base. But normally you cannot get hold of this class. So what do? People retransform method handles, and you take, for example, the public lookup method, and you hard code just a thread ID into the method and say, like, if I'm this very special thread, give me the good one, not the boring one. And then you have a lookup instance that just allows you to define everything. This is quite efficient as well. So this is a good drop-in replacement for Sun Miscon Safe as well. So, and here are the results. We used to do this, right? Sun Miscon Safe. Java Lang Invoke method handle, what I just showed, is a bit slower. I assume it's because of security checks on the way. And the package written thing is just a complete disaster. So the unfortunate property of these solutions is that the gray bad block there is the only one that's official API. So as of today, you can already do all injection and all packages, but you will have to pay a high price for it. And that's the other reason why I think people will stay at Sun Miscon Safe or JDK and Total Miscon Safe until this issue is resolved. And JDK and Total Miscon actually scares me because a lot of agents, or most agents, are just loaded on the system class loader. And then they just open the JDK internal MISC unsafe package to the unnamed module of the system class loader where all code runs and then everybody has access to everything again, right? So you entirely disable the module system for this VM because having this instance, you can again define classes around everywhere and do everything you want. So I hope that before a lot of people go over to JDK internal MISC unsafe as a solution, there will be a better API that allows that. And the easiest way, of course, would be to remove the restriction of just defining classes in a certain package. Right. So much for Java agents. This is not a big problem. I think just one API that resembles unsafe define class would be enough, in my opinion. And as I demonstrated, you already have the capability of defining classes in any package. So I don't think it's a security issue at all to just offer that functionality. All right. So we have defining class from libraries as well. This is, for example, the Mockito use case. Mockito is not a Java agent. Mockito is a library, the subclass instrumentation. And that's a solved problem, right? So if we create a mock of user class, we get an instance of user class, and this class is supposed to be a subclass. A lot of people don't really know that that's the way it works, but I guess you guys have the understanding of the Java language and the VM to understand that this is just a subclass generated dynamically where all methods are overridden to call back into the Mockito library to basically display a certain behavior, right? And if everything's on the unnamed module, which for 99% of people is the case, this will just work, right? So last week, for the first time, we had someone that actually used modules in tests. Where this didn't work anymore, right? Because the user module is a module of its own and it doesn't open its packages to the unnamed module. And even worse, there is no mechanism for that either because Mockito is a test library. Mockito won't be mentioned in the module info. I don't know if nobody thought of this, but there's no good way in Java or in build tools or in test plugins for Maven or Gradle to even express that. You have to write the command line stuff yourself as a startup parameter for your test JVM, but then you have to fork it, and not everybody forks the test VM either, because that adds time to testing and everything. So we're stuck, right? We can't do this using method handle define class. So the fallback now is, of course, again, SunMisc unsafe. But in 11, SunMisc unsafe disappeared, and people came to us and complained, obviously, that they wanted to run their test suites. They have an enterprise application that ran for 10 years, and suddenly they update Java because they don't want to pay. And their free library doesn't work anymore. What a shame. Right. So what we do, right? The unsafe, we all know how the dance goes. SunMisc unsafe declared field, the unsafe, set it accessible, get the instance out, define class. This disappeared, as we mentioned. So we cannot do JDK internal MISC unsafe get declared field because set accessible won't work. It won't be allowed since this is in a module that's not our module, right? So it's not accessible anymore. But we can just get the declared field. Then we use unsafe to get the field offset for the field. And then we just write a Boolean directly using unsafe to the field. And again, we have access to Sun Misgun Safe, or JDK Internal Misgun Safe. They tweeted out happily, and then JDK 12 came out, and this field was explicitly filtered away from reflection. Just this one field. So people complained again. JDK 12, they want to run, I don't know, you have like Lucene and all these libraries that want to be early adopters because they're in the high performance field. They want to have the benefits of the new releases like startup time and so forth. It's like, do something. And what is the solution? The solution actually took us just 1 hour to implement, which is funny in the light that a release takes half a year. We basically just take the class file of accessible object, we copy the class file, rename it, load it in a disposable class loader, compute the offset from that class, because the layout will just be the same layout as the accessible object. Now we use this object, and we're back in the game.
Maybe you will randomize the layout.
Yeah, maybe I'll find out. But that's the thing, we find the layout at at runtime, and then people segfault. So do you want them to segfault? Again, and I see why you don't want it make accessible, but for us, we are testing library. People want that, right? People have an active desire to do this, and it's for a good reason. You want to mock classes. I know it's not the intended use, but it's a very useful use. Mockito, I think we have, I don't want to lie, I think it's 600 million downloads a year. That's the dimension. I don't know how often the JVM gets downloaded, but Mockito is very actively used. Every customer I'm at, it's used in some regard. So there's a definite need for this. So
it's
we don't want. Yeah, exactly. I'll get to that. But the problem is, I'm an individual. A CHEP is such a complicated procedure for. Yeah. So also, again, before the direct, and this is a bad test, this is bad benchmarking, but it's an approximation. It takes about 4 times as long to do the whole dance of setting up the JDK internal MISC on safe access without the restriction of doing the reflecting and class file copy stuff than it is now. And think about, this is mocking. This is run from unit tests, so people run individual tests on their machine. And if you have all this overhead, we just have to set it up once. And we talked about this before. The JVM is really built for peak performance. People come to us and they say, Java 8 was so fast, and now in Java